Hi there. Here's mental coach Chato from the Tennis Academy Ball Planet in Magdeburg, Germany. Welcome to another edition of my mental training online program. We're continuing today the discussion of Napoleon's Hill, Think and Grow Rich, famous work, and the chapter that we're discussing today is on persistence. As he calls it, the eighth step toward riches. He defines persistence as the sustained effort necessary to induce fate. And what Napoleon Hill addresses in this chapter is that there are many people who fail, like the majority of people fail at what they truly desire to achieve. And he says that it's not that because they are not as good as the success, as the champions, or they lack something, is that they don't have persistence, which means that by the first sign of failure, they quit. They see themselves as not successful, as failures, and they just leave the project. Whereas successful people don't quit after failing, they just fail again and again and again until they succeed. Something else that Napoleon Hill says in his book, in this chapter, is that, again, desire is directly connected to your persistence level, and that he says weak desires produce weak results and a very strong desire produces a very strong result. And he says that if you have a weak desire to achieve whatever it is that you want to achieve, it's very likely that you're not going to persist at achieving it. Whereas if you have a very strong desire, a couple of failures or setbacks are not going to make you quit your project. So have a greater desire and you have more persistence. He mentions throughout his book, not only this chapter, about famous people's successes and failures, such as Ford, for example, Henry Ford, and also Thomas Edison. Thomas Edison, for example, the inventor of the light bulb, maybe his most famous creation, is cited, he's quoted to say, "I did not fail, I just found 10,000 ways that are not working." So this is exactly what Napoleon Hill means. Failing does not mean quitting. Failing just means I have to try another way. And he also mentions Henry Ford as an example somewhere through the book. He says that Henry Ford was working on a project trying to, I believe he was talking about the four cylinder motors, something that was not invented yet. So he just gathered his engineers and he said, "I want you to create this." And they said, "But that's not possible, this does not exist." And he said, "Well, just create it." And they worked for years, for months, and tried, and they tried this and this and that, all the time failing. And after 1 year, they told him, "It's we're failing, it's no point, this cannot be done." And Henry Ford said, "Okay, I understand, but continue trying." And after some months again, some breakthrough came and they did invent this thing, exactly what he wanted. And of course, he became a pioneer with that invention. Again, many failures, many people telling you that you will fail did not bother him. That's why he succeeded. And what's interesting also in this chapter is that Napoleon Hill offers again a certain formula for increasing your persistence, or at least he mentions a lot of factors that are influencing your persistence, and I'm going to read them out loud for you now. The first thing that he mentions is definiteness of purpose. Knowing what one wants is the first and perhaps the most important step toward the development of persistence. A strong motive forces one to surmount many difficulties. Again, what I said, if you truly want something, you're more likely to achieve it. So, knowing exactly what you want. Second is desire. Also, I discussed it. It is comparatively easy to acquire and to maintain persistence in pursuing the object of intense desire. Yeah. Self-reliance, he also argues, is connected to persistence. Belief in one's ability to carry out a plan encourages one to follow the plan through with persistence. Self-reliance can be developed through the principle described in the chapter on old suggestion, meaning affirmations. Again, an obvious truth, one that I talked to you about many times, is that if I have self-confidence, if I believe in myself, then I can do this thing, whatever it is that I'm starting, that I'm more likely, a lot more likely to persist in doing it than if I have an image of myself of being a failure. So that's why, again, we have to change our self-image, which I talked about in the previous sessions. We have to increase our self-confidence, by which we can use Napoleon's Hill formula that I quoted maybe 3 sessions ago. And we can use also old suggestion to increase our self-confidence. And again, this is an obvious truth, as I said, because if you look it in your life, it is very often the people that are self-confident, that believe in themselves, that have a good attitude, that attract us, and not the people who necessarily no more have a title like a doctor or professor. We are attracted and we tend to like people more who have self-confidence. And this is for a reason. Automatically, this means they have more persistence in themselves and more likely to achieve whatever they are beginning. The next factor is definiteness of plans. Organized plans, even though they may be weak and entirely impractical, encourage persistence. Again, it makes sense if I know that I have a plan, that I'm more likely, it increases my confidence in this venture, and I'm more likely to persist or to try at least a couple of more times. Accurate knowledge is the next factor. Knowing that one's plans are sound based upon experience or observation encourages persistence. Guessing instead of knowing destroys persistence. A perfect example, again, with training hours that I gave you within last session or session before the last session, that specialized knowledge costs nothing. And the example is of an A-class trainer, tennis trainer in Germany, costs 50 euros, which is nothing, but it's a lot better to give this trainer 50 euros and ask him which way to take, what to do, am I going the right way, instead of just guessing. Because if I'm guessing, I don't even know if I'm taking the right way, and as there are so many ways, it's very likely that I'm taking the wrong way. Whereas if I give the 50 euros, I ask the trainer and he tells me, go this way, do this and this and that, and I know that I'm walking the right way. So even if I meet with temporary failure, I have the security and the reliance that I am doing the right thing and that I will succeed eventually. So, of course, it will increase my persistence. Next one is cooperation. Sympathy, understanding, and harmonious cooperation with others tend to develop persistence. Again, if I'm alone, I'm a lot easier, a lot more likely to get discouraged. Whereas if I work with other people, even if I fail, but here they have sympathy, encouraging me, telling me that I'm actually doing the right thing, especially if those are people that are trying to achieve the same thing, so working in my field, this is going to maybe help me persist more. Willpower is the next factor, and by that, watch, it doesn't mean, willpower does not mean I force myself to do whatever I'm doing, but the habit of concentrating one's thoughts upon the building of plans for the attainment of a definite purpose leads to persistence. So, as willpower, he defines not me resisting sweets or pushing through the pain. Willpower is the strength that I find in myself to focus, to concentrate my thoughts on whatever it is that I want to achieve. This is willpower. So, just the strength, the ability to concentrate on whatever I want to achieve, and not what you see in the movies, doing 10 push-ups and then doing just one more on the verge of collapsing. And that's not what he means by willpower. The last factor is habit. Persistence is the direct result of habit. The mind absorbs and becomes a part of the daily experiences upon which it feeds. Fear, the worst of all enemies, can be effectively cured by forced repetition of courage. Everyone who has seen active service in war knows this. Habit, as he puts it, is we are creatures of habit. I also talked to you about habits in my very first sessions. Habit is something that we always work on habits. We do something, we learn it, it becomes a habit, and then we do it automatically without thinking about it. We are creatures of habit. So as soon as we create a habit within ourselves, it's very easy to persist. So if we're in the habit of fighting through failures, that's perfect habit, because then we're very successful. If we are in the habit of giving up soon enough, then we're likely to achieve nothing. And just an illustration of how powerful habits are: people that eat sweets that cannot stop, people that drink alcohol and cannot stop, people who smoke and cannot stop, people who bite their nails and can't stop. These all habits that are automatic within us, but bad habits, and we're even unable, although we consciously know they are good, they are not good, we can't stop them. So habits are powerful, and obviously if I'm in the habit of being persistent, or in the habit of continuing doing something, even though it looks like a failure, I'm very likely to succeed. That's all for today in this chapter. Until next time.